Hello. I come to you today with a review of The Water Dancer by Ta-Nehisi Coates, a 2019 debut novel. All follows a Hiram Walker who was born into slavery, product of his father, a white plantation owner, and his mother, a figure that, despite his photographic memory, is shrouded in haze. He cannot remember her. As a young man, at the kind of the opening of the novel, he survives a sudden shift. We find through the kind of the early parts of the novel, he is actually kind of he is teleported, conducted is what they call it, conducting. He has conducted himself and his half brother, white brother, into the river, where he survives. He gets out of the river again, perhaps through conduction again, while his white brother drowns. This kind of through these events, he decides that he needs to escape. He needs to get out of this place that he has known all his life, this Virginia plantation. So begins a kind of a journey from this kind of fading, rotten grandeur of Virginia, into the kind of into desperate guerrilla cells, to a kind of utopic movement in the north. And it's definitely a novel where idealism clashes with a kind of desire to rescue the family he's left behind. It's basically it's a novel where, very literally, in this kind of interesting alternative fantasy world, where me memory is literally power, in this novel. It's an it, this is it's an interesting, slightly kind of alternative world. Instead of, there being kind of there being slaves and masters, there are taskers, and the white aristocracy is known as quality. There are hounds, Ryland's hounds, that track down escaped slaves. It's a world where there people have power, have strange powers, conduction being one of them. This power of being able to teleport, it seems. He throughout this novel, it's very much Ta-Nehisi's talked about how he wanted to make a kind of a hero, a superhero story, from these experiences, not just like strictly as black people, as victims under slavery, but as active protagonists in sort of an adventure. And it definitely a lot of there's some of the a lot of the writing here has that kind of an adventure quality to it, where it's like, we're going on adventures, as he gets into the underground system here. Very much he is there's an adventure quality to it, while at the same time, it's never like, oh gee golly, Swift Adventure. We're always kind of grounded in Hiram and his kind of trying to come into the memory of his of a very real loss, and just kind of and the trauma of being under the system, but also just how this world, the slavery, very much completely mapping on to slavery in the South, how it destroyed black families, rip them apart. I mean, he is the product of the rape of a black woman by a white plantation owner. There can be no consent, but I really don't think there was, in this case. It's also kind of an interesting thing because Hiram has white allies when he gets to the underground. But it's interesting how, at least how he characterizes certain white allies as saying that, particular one, Karina, is that, it wasn't so much that she didn't really care about the black people under the system as much as she was offended by slavery itself and what barbarity her fellow whites descended to. That's the thing that was like that. That's the thing she cared about. She didn't really didn't really care about the individual people, that they were, that was completely unimportant to her, whereas Hiram is very much coming at it from you know, I care about my family, I care about the people I've left behind, and you know, just because they're not useful to the cause is not going to shape my how my actions. Or that's indeed what, that's one of the conflicts that happens there. Though really Hiram, he is a hero. You understand right from the beginning that he is not going to leave his family behind. Because it does have kind of this hero structure to it, like, you know, Hiram has got super photographic memory, he's got all these abilities, it's like he's a hero, he's gonna like start doing amazing stuff, that the end of this book, it fits much more into the whole thing of memory and of family and stuff like that, which leads to a conclusion which isn't the easy conclusion, which is, you know, Hiram goes on some kind of rampage and brings down the system. It's not, we don't get that fantastical. This is much more, we circle back to this ideas of memory, and memory is power, and of family. But it's, there's in a sense that it feels more intellectually satisfying than it does emotionally satisfying, at least for me as a reader. You know, it's one of these books where you think it's like, ah, this is the origin story, and then we're going to get, but then we stop. the book stops at that point. So I'm complaining the book is too short, which is a good thing, right? I think probably the other thing that hangs over this book, at least for my reading of it, is I read Colson Whitehead's The Underground Railroad, which won the Pulitzer Prize and was, like, you know, a book well into Whitehead's career, and very mature, dense work. It's a 2016 novel, you know, so it came out 3 years before this, which is also about an underground railway made more literal. But it's also probably Whitehead is much more literary, and is a lot more kind of deadpan. It's interesting because like Ta-Nehisi Coates very much tries to make a world and makes his own language for the fantasy elements, as much as, and the alternate society, but it still very much feels like somebody who's a little bit more comfortable in the fantasy realm than Colson Whitehead, who is definitely much more into the magic realism realm. And I think Colson Whitehead has talked about how he's dialed down those fantastic elements to a one, whereas Ta-Nehisi Coates is definitely more of a 6-7 6-7 range, while not losing sight of, he's not making it into a fun slavery book for entertainment purposes. He's not doing that. But it's, in some ways, The Water Dancer is more accessible, more immediately accessible, though I had a lot of troubles getting into The Underground Railroad, and it's kind of the austere kind of dialing down kind of pushed me away. And also that was a book that it was so much more subtle in its approach that as somebody who doesn't have a proper education about Black history, I found it difficult to spot when the changes were being made. It's like, seriously, it wasn't until after I had finished the book and read reviews, I went, oh, you mean all those places they went along the way weren't actual places? Those were different segments of time and place all combined together into a blender. It's like, I was that clueless of a reader. So maybe, you know, having done some of that reading, I come to this and it's like, oh, there's a character named Harriet who's also Moses and who also has conduction, kind of semi-conduction skills. It's like, oh, who could that be? It's like, now I've got an idea. There's historical people in this novel that I actually recognize this time. So, it's strange. I think Colson Whitehead's book is the one I'm more likely to have to want to go back to, because I can see there's more in there. Whereas this definitely feels like kind of a debut novel that we're like, it's like it's got kind of maybe some of those problems of a debut novel having, of not quite pulling off that ending, and of just also feeling a little bit lighter. But maybe that's just also because it's so tough when you have somebody who's obviously super, super worked out a lot of stuff, like Colson Whitehead, and you can't help but do the comparison with Ta-Nehisi Coates, which isn't really fair, but you know, it comes up in your mind. I have to say, I think I probably, and it's probably bullshit to kind of compare them together. I can see two different types of readers actually enjoying this book, of the being a bit more on the literary side would be with the Colson Whitehead, a little bit more on the fantasy side would be a Ta-Nehisi Coates, even though he does avoid actually giving you a fantasy ending, which is kind of appropriate because it's fantasy mixed with the very real kind of history and trauma and kind of real world stuff that you can't go full fantasy, or if you did, you'd have to figure out a way. It does feel like a book where it's like, oh, and then the exciting stuff's going to happen next. But that's just a really weird surface expectation I have as a fantasy reader, which it's not appropriate here. It's not appropriate here. So that's my thoughts on The Water Dancer. I'm just going to leave it there, and we'll go on to our next video. All right. More videos later.